So we have now a general second degree equation, and we know that from our conic section experience that a general second degree equation would have a second degree term, it will have linear terms also, and it can have constant term also. Okay, so this is what we call as a general second degree equation. Now this equation, other than representing a conic, that is circle, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola, that we have already seen, can also represent a pair of straight lines. That means it could be a representative of something like, you know, Lx, My plus N1, or you can say N, into another line equation, something like this. Okay. And from now, from this equation, it must be very obvious that they will not pass through origin. Guys, if any pair of straight lines have to pass through origin, then the C term will definitely be not there. Okay, so one of them may pass through, but both of them will not intersect at the origin. That means the intersection point will be some other point other than the origin. Okay, if they have to intersect at origin, G, F and C terms would all be zero. That means it would convert itself to a homogeneous second degree equation. Okay, now we have already seen in our past that second degree equation can represent conics. So how can we say that, or what condition must we have such that this will represent a pair of straight lines? Okay, let us talk about that. And then we'll also use that to see what is the intersection point of the two lines represented by this second degree general equation. So do you remember when I started the session of conic with you last year, I had given an expression delta. Right? Do you remember delta expression? A, B, C, 2, F, G, H, minus A, F square, minus B, G square, minus C, S square. And I had given you the fact that if delta is zero, then this second degree equation, let me write it as S, D, E, will represent a pair of straight lines. And I did not prove this particular fact that time. Now the time has come that I should prove this for you. So listen to this proof very, very carefully. Yeah, that coffee thing. I don't want to repeat this. It's getting recorded. That's why. Okay. So this condition, that ugly condition, ABC 2FGH minus AF square minus GS, BG square minus CS square. If this is equal to zero, then it would represent a pair of straight lines. Okay, if it is not zero, it can represent, you know, circle, parabola, ellipse, hyperbola. That's what we had discussed in our last year discussion. So now we'll prove it. So I'm going to give you various proofs for it. Okay, I'm going to do various proofs for it. The first proof, let's look into this. If you look at this equation, okay, can I say this equation is like a quadratic in X? Okay, let me write it like this so that you are able to relate that it's a quadratic in X. So AX square I've copied, okay, and X term I'm segregating it out. So let's say 2X, I have HY and G, and this is like a constant term, you can say, for the time being. So what I'm doing, I'm treating it as a quadratic.
So what about by square?
Oh, I'm so sorry. By square. Thank you, Richard, for pointing that out. Thank you so much. Yeah. So I'm treating this as a quadratic in X. Okay. Now, if I have a quadratic in X, I can use my Sridhar Acharya formula or quadratic equation formula to represent X as minus B. Minus, so B will be 2HY plus G, so minus B plus minus B square, that's 4 hy plus g square minus 4 ac. C you can write dy square 2fy plus c. Okay, by 2a. By 2a. Okay, now all of you please listen to my claim over here. If I say, if this has to represent a pair of straight lines, then the quantity within the under root, that is this quantity, which I am underlining with white, this must be a perfect square. Would you agree with me on that? And why is that so? Is because if this is not a perfect square, I will end up seeing these radical powers on the variables, which is highly unacceptable when you are dealing with straight line equations. Have you ever seen a straight line where if you represent your x in terms of y, you have some kind of radical powers coming up in x and y? Never. Correct? So if it has to be linearly factorized, this term which is underlined with white must be a perfect square. Yes or no? Anybody who thinks this argument is not acceptable, please let me know. Clear? Okay. So if I'm claiming that this guy, I'm writing it now separately. So the term which I've underlined, I'm writing it separately. So I'm claiming that this fellow is a perfect square. This fellow is a perfect square. Can I say then this equal to zero will have equal roots? Because equal roots come from those expressions which are perfect square. Correct? In other words, what I'm trying to say is that drop the factor of 4. This equation will have equal roots. Okay? And this is an equation in Y. So let me just write it in a proper quadratic in Y. So y square will have coefficient. I have to write it in terms of y. So y square will have coefficient h square minus ab. Okay. It will have 2 gh minus afy. So I'm just handpicking the terms. Let me know if I am missing out on any terms. And constant terms would be g square minus ac. So this should have equal roots. I've got some message from someone. Why equal roots? Okay. Richard, if this is a perfect square, correct? Then an equation which is equated to zero. So this is something square, correct? So won't this have equal roots in terms of y? Because equal roots come from those expressions which are perfect squares. For example, if I say, I'm saying this is a perfect square because it is x minus 1 square. So the moment you equate it to 0, you'll end up getting equal roots for it, isn't it? Is that clear now, Ruchir? Now, in that case, I can say the discriminant of it, that is b square minus 4ac. I'm changing the color here. Should be equal to zero, correct? So b square, that is 4 gh minus af the whole square minus 4 ac minus 4 ac. This should be equal to zero, okay? Let me drop the factor of 4 from both the sides. This 4 and this 4, let me drop it off. Let me open the brackets. So here I will have h square g square minus you'll have 2 AFGH and you have AF square. Here if I open multiply them, I'll get H square G square minus ACH square minus ABG square and plus A square BC. Okay. If I open the brackets, you can well see that H square G square term will vanish off. And drop A throughout. Yeah, Dhruv.
A square.
Yeah, that's what I was explaining, Dhruv, that has to be a perfect square, because if it is not, then it will lead to some kind of under root expressions on Y. So it will not represent a straight line, right? Straight line is never known to have radical powers on y. They're all power of one. That's why I'm claiming it to be a perfect square. Dhruv, does it satisfy your question, this thing? Query?
Yeah.
So now if you drop an A from everywhere, okay, if I drop an A from everywhere, you'll end up getting minus 2 FGH, okay, and there's an A square over here, yeah. And there is an A dropped from here, so you'll get AF square. There's an A dropped from here, you'll get CH square, A dropped from here plus BG square, and you'll have minus ABC. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay, so if you multiply throughout with a negative sign, you'll end up getting ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CH square equal to zero. And this is what we wanted to prove, hence proved.
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, about the perfect square, couldn't it also be equal to some other perfect square and then there'll come a constant? And then when we subtract it, that could have equal roots.
Sorry?
So, like, let's say that 4 thing is equal to 25, the entire expression.
Okay.
So then we subtract 25 and say that that equations must have equal roots. Would that also satisfy?
That will also work. But, at the end of the day, you are claiming this to be a perfect square in themselves. So if you equate it to zero, it should have equal roots. That is also fine. See, you're trying to say, you're trying to say P square is some Q square, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. And then you're trying to form, that is also fine. That will also, try it out. That should also give you the same result. But unnecessarily, you are introducing some other variable into it.
So can you scroll up a bit? I need to take the initial thing. I got disconnected.
Okay. You can take a snapshot if you want.
Okay, sir. So I'll just write down the initial and final thing.
Sure. Ruchir, does it answer your question? So even if you take it, it should not matter. It should not matter. But again, why would it be a constant when you have variables y involved inside it?
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay. So try to think in that angle also.
Yes, sir.
Now, one thing that I would like to hear from you, what if A were zero? Okay. Now, if A were zero,
I have a doubt.
The conditions will not be affected. I'll take that in the next this thing. You have done it? Whoever was copying, are you done with the copying part?
Yes, sir. Can you scroll up to the top of the page?
For sure.
Sir?
Yes, sir. Tell me.
Sir.
Yeah, Rahul, you're asking something?
No, sir. I just wanted to copy it.
Okay.
So I didn't understand why the claim, why is that thing a perfect square? The one underlined in white.
Oh my God, I'm explaining this for the third time now. See, have you ever seen something like x is equal to root y plus 1 by something as a let's say equation of a straight line? Correct?
No.
Do you have something like this as an equation of a straight line? I mean, some y function. Let me not just write y. Just some y function. This function of y, let's say. Okay. Plus some constant 1 or something. So this is not possible. That's why if this term within the under root sign, if this doesn't come out to be a perfect square, you'll end up getting all radical powers on y. Or there would be such an expression which will have something like, you know, a quadratic under root. Isn't it? So imagine as if you have been given an equation of a straight line like this. Let's say, okay. Does it look like a straight line equation? It will not. This guy has to be a perfect square. It has to be a linear term in y. That's why I claimed here that this expression should be a perfect square.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, got it, Richard.
Got it.
Okay. Now, if A
so
will...
That final expression was the general form, right? For the... The final expression which it got, the ABC plus 2FGH.
Right.
That's the general this thing, right?
That's the general condition for any second degree general equation to represent a pair of straight lines.
Okay, sir.
So if that condition is met, we say that that second degree equation which has been provided would represent a pair of straight lines.
Okay, sir.
Getting the point. Now, if a is equal to 0, you would realize that your equation ax square plus 2hxy plus by square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0, this term would vanish, correct? And you would be only left with by square, let's say 2yhx plus f plus 2gx plus c. Now I'm treating it as a quadratic in y. Yes, kind of, correct. Correct here. Okay, that means one of the equations actually doesn't have an x in it. Okay, now, are you there with me, guys? Yeah, I'm back. As I told you, the power went off and it has come back now. Sorry for the inconvenience. Now, here also, if I use my
second way of doing the proof.
Yeah, second, before second way, Kritika, we'll have to clear off the fact that what if A becomes zero? Will that condition change? If not, what will happen? What will be the new condition? Let's talk about that. Okay. So if you see now, I have made it as a quadratic in Y. Okay. Again, by using the Sridhar Acharya formula, I can say y is equal to minus b plus minus under root b square minus 4ac. Okay. By 2b. Yes or no? Now, just like my previous argument, can I say this has to be a perfect square? Because we have never known any kind of a linear equation of a line which has got under root of a quadratic in x, isn't it? That means this equation should have equal roots by the very same argument. Oh my God. Hello, are you there? Can you hear me, guys?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So, yes, sir. For this equation, I can say x square coefficient will be h square. Okay. X will be hf minus 2bg. And constant terms would be f square minus bc. Okay. So here also the discriminant, which is b square minus 4ac, must be equal to 0. So b square, that is 4 times hf minus bg square, should be equal to 4ac. Is that fine? No, sufficient enough, don't worry. It can last. Okay, so what we do is now we cancel out the 4 factor from both the sides, expand it. So it gives me h square f square minus 2 H, or you can 2B, FGH, plus B square G square. And this side I will have, you can, let me write it like this, minus BCH square. So cancel off H square, F square from both the sides. Cancel one factor of B from both the sides. So you'll end up getting minus 2FGH plus BG square, right? Plus CH square equal to 0. Multiply with a negative 1. So you end up getting this condition. Now, what I claim here is that the condition has not changed from this. You just have A becoming 0 everywhere. Check it out, guys. So this condition still holds here. It's just that now your A is becoming 0. So this term has vanished. This term has vanished. So only this term will survive. So there is no change in the condition whatsoever. Now many people ask, sir, what about if B is also 0? Because here you have B also. Correct? That could also be a possibility. Yes or no? So yes, so that's the question Vikas has asked. What if B is 0? Very good question. So now we'll take a situation, Vikas, where we have A and B both as zeros. Okay. In that case, can I say your pair of straight lines equation, that is this equation, will not have this term, will not have this term, okay? That will only have xy term, x and y. Okay? So I will have an equation of this nature. Now, here both conditions are happening together. That's why I'm taking it separately. I know the first condition can take care of the fact that B is zero. So now I'm taking care when both of these happen together. Okay? Now listen to this here. I'll multiply throughout by H by 2. I'll tell you why I'm doing that. So when I do that, I get H square XY. I get HGX. I get HFY. And I get CH by 2. Okay. Now, let me send this CH by 2 on the other side. So I'll make it equal to minus CH by 2. Okay. Let me add an FG term on both the sides. FG term on both the sides. Okay. Now, from these two terms, I'll take an HX common. So I'll get HY plus G. And from these two terms, I will take an F term common. I'll again get HY plus G. And on the right hand side, I get FG minus CH by 2. This is factorizable as HX plus F in times HY plus G is equal to FG minus CH by 2. Now guys, listen to my claim here. If this were to represent a pair of straight lines, then this guy should have been 0. Can somebody tell me why? You can unmute yourself and speak. What will happen if this term were not 0? What would it represent then? Anybody? See, if you see this, take an H common. Take an H common. Let's say this is a non-zero term. Okay, let's say some value K. If K is not equal to 0, do you realize that this expression will actually look like something XY is equal to a non-zero value. Okay, let me call it as C, and C is not 0.
So when you took H common, why did you put a Y over there?
Sorry?
There's a Y under the F. Shouldn't that be a X?
My bad. Slip of pen. Yeah. Okay. So if C is not zero, what does this equation represent?
Correct.
Right? It represent a rectangular hyperbola. It will not represent a pair of straight lines. Okay. So what should happen is that this term should have been zero. That means 2fg should be minus ch should be equal to zero. That means 2fgh minus ch square should have been zero. And you can very well see that this situation actually emerges from the very same condition that we started with, where you have put your A and B both as zero. So if A and B both are zero, these terms will vanish off. And only 2fgh and ch square would be left off. And that's why even if A and B both are zero, the condition still persists to be true. Okay. Now, let's move on to the second proof of the same thing. For the second proof, I would use the fact that a homogeneous second degree equation, mind you, homogeneous second degree equation would always represent a pair of straight lines passing through origin. Correct? This is what we had learned in our before break session. Correct? So I will say that let this particular equation that we have, okay, meets at x1, y1. Okay? Some point x1, y1, the pair of lines which is represented by this equation, it meets at x1, y1. Correct, Shreya, correct. Now what I'll do, I will shift my origin to that point x1, y1. Why am I doing that? See, look at this figure carefully. This was the pair of straight lines represented by this equation, correct? Now what I'm doing is my origin was somewhere and I'm shifting my origin to this point. That means I'm shifting my origin to x1, y1. So 0, 0 has gone to x1, y1. In that scenario, how would this equation change?
So would the constant term disappear?
It should disappear. And moreover, coefficient of x should also disappear and coefficient of y should also disappear, isn't it? Because yeah. If your origin comes to this position, let me write it in white. If your origin comes to this position, it would convert itself to a homogeneous degree equation. Correct. So, but that is not my question. My question is, what would that new form of this equation be? What should I replace my x with?
X1.
Guys, this is a all-time confusion that everybody has. If your origin shifts to h, k, your old x becomes new x plus h, old y becomes new y plus k. This has to be committed to memory. Please, please, please keep this result very, very handy and ready. You can't miss out on those. So what will happen to this equation?
It will become x minus x.
Ax, let me write minus it as capital x, plus x1 whole square, b capital y plus y1 whole square, plus 2h capital x plus x1 capital y plus y1, 2g capital X plus X1, 2F capital Y plus Y1, plus C equal to zero. And I claim that this equation, let me name it as equation, let me call it as one, and let me call it as two. I claim that two is a homogeneous second degree equation. That is, the coefficient of X, coefficient of y and the constant term must all be zero. Agreed, my dear, or not? If no, please stop me and ask questions.
So the capital X is the old center.
the new x, the new variable of the equation.
Okay.
So this will result, what I'm claiming is that this would result into something like this. Sorry for using capital A and B also, but this would result into a second degree homogeneous equation like this. That's what I'm claiming. Is my claim correct?
Yes, sir.
What will happen if the coefficient of x and y is not zero?
Coefficient of x, y will be zero under this condition. That's what I'm going to write next. This would lead to the coefficient of x and y and constant term being equal to zero. Your x1, y1, b, g, h, a, etc. would be in such a way, Dhruv, that it would result to be zero for sure.
Oh, okay.
Because we have established this as a theory in the previous discussion. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, can you all help me with the coefficient of x first? What will be the coefficient of x over here? I claim it's going to be 2ax1 from this guy. This guy will give me this guy will give me 2g. So let me write 2g also. There will be no x here. Next, there will be an x over here. So that will be 2hy1. Just let me know if I'm missing out on any term. Okay, which further implies that ax1 hy1 plus g would be equal to 0. Let me call it as 3. Okay. Now, all of you, please help me to get the coefficient of y from this expression. You don't have to expand it. Now, let's not waste our time expanding. Let's handpick terms. This will never give me a capital Y. This will give me 2by1. So let me write 2by1. Okay. This guy will give me 2hx1. Okay. And this will give me 2f. So can I say this is as we are saying hx1 by1 plus f equal to 0? Let me call it as fourth equation. Okay. Now, constant term should also be 0. Now help me out with the constant terms. I'll have ax1 square. I will have this will give me by1 square. I'll write that later on. Okay, let me write it here only, by1 square. I will have from this term 2hx1y1. Okay. And from this term, I will get 2gx1. From this term, I will have 2fy1 plus c equal to 0. Okay. Let me call this as the fifth equation. Now, all of you, I would like you to pay attention over here. Very, very important step. This fifth equation, I'm going to write in such a way that I include 3 and 4 within it. See, how will I do that? This is ax1 square, correct? So I would write it as x1 into ax1, okay? And I'm going to introduce this entire term over here. Okay, and I'll see what extra term do I have to incorporate to complete fifth. So you can see ax1 square is already taken care of. Hx1 y1 is partially taken care of. So I need one more Hx1 y1. So what I'll do is I'll introduce y1 Hx1 and this entire term I will write over here. Now pay attention. Ax1 square is taken care of. Hx1 y1, Hx1 y1 means 2Hx1 y1 is taken care of. By1 square is taken care of. Okay. And gx1 and fy1 is taken care of. So one more gx1 and fy1 scope is there. And of course, c. So this fifth equation, I have just rewritten like this. Is this understood? This is a very, very important step. Just take a time and see whether you have understood it. Then only I'll move forward. Done? Understood? Any doubt, any kind of void in understanding? Let me know. Now, people are wondering, why did I do this? because I could safely write this as 0 and this as 0 from 3 and 4, isn't it? So which finally leads me to the fact that gx1 plus fy1 plus c is equal to 0. Let me call it as the sixth equation. Okay. Now the time has come that I summarize here. If you see that third, fourth, and sixth, these three equations seem to suggest this and this guy. They seem to suggest that AXHY plus G equal to 0, HX plus BY plus F equal to 0, and GX plus FY plus C equal to 0 represent concurrent lines. Why concurrent lines, my dear? Because they're all passing through x1, y1. Correct. And if you had learned your condition for concurrency in your straight lines chapter, I'm sure most of you would have an idea about determinants. In physics, you must have done it. Then the coefficients here must be 0. Yes or no, this is your condition for concurrency. If not, you can open your R.D. Sharma and you will find this condition for concurrency there in your R.D. Sharma book also. Okay, it's present everywhere. Any standard book you pick up, you will get this condition for concurrency for this state line. Okay, or alternately, you can solve these two, put it in the third one. You will end up getting the expansion of this determinant. And what is that? ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CS square equal to 0. So this is the expanded. If you expand this, you will end up getting this expression. Getting my point? So either you use condition for concurrency. If you don't know that, solve the first two or solve any two and put it in the third. You'll end up getting this expression. There's another way to look at it. But only when you have done your determinants chapter, I will tell you. There is something called non-trivial solution. So if a system of equation which is like this, it is called a homogeneous system of linear equations. If it has a non-trivial solution, this determinant will come into picture. But that is something which you will not understand right now. We'll wait for determinants chapter to revisit this concept. Okay. So are you convinced with the second proof also?
Sir.
Okay, now here comes one more understanding which probably emerges from third and fourth. So all of you, I would like you to look at third and fourth equation once again. Something which actually is very interesting. It says that the point of intersection of the two straight lines which were represented by that pair of equation, second degree linear, general second degree equation, can also be obtained by solving 3 and 4 simultaneously, correct? So x1, y1, right, can be obtained by solving 3 and 4. Agreed? Yes or no? So you must be thinking, why 3 and 4? Why not sir is talking 4 and 6? Okay. The 3 and 4 is something which you can obtain in this way. All of you, please pay attention. Okay. Go back to this equation. Call this expression as S for the time being. Do you remember the S term which we were using every time in our conic section? S stands for second degree. Okay. Now I would like you to do this operation. Dou S by dou X equal to 0. Now, people who are wondering, what is dou s and dou x? It means partial derivative with respect to x. Partial derivative with respect to x. What is meaning of with respect to x? Means only x has to be treated as a variable. Rest all the terms would be treated as constants. Getting my point, everybody?
Yes.
So do a partial derivative of s with respect to x and tell me the result. won't you get 2ax? I'm writing it over here. 2ax by differentiating this guy. What is the derivative? What is the partial derivative of by square with respect to x?
Zero.
What is the partial derivative of this guy?
2hy.
2hy. What is the partial derivative of 2gx?
2g.
Can I say these two will again give you zero?
Zero.
Can I say that it will end up giving you, I'm sorry,
ax plus hy plus g equal to 0.
Plus g equal to 0. You see that the same equation I had got over here also. You see this?
Yeah.
Okay. In a similar way, you would realize that the second one, that is your
partial derivative with respect to y.
Y, yeah, very good. Right. If you do a partial derivative with respect to y, you can check it out over here. You'll end up getting 2by. You'll end up getting 2hx. Okay.
It's 2f.
And you'll end up getting 2f equal to 0. That means it'll give you hx plus by plus f equal to 0. That is the same thing that we had written over here or here, whatever you want to see. So what I'm claiming is that this x and y, x1 and y1, that is the point of intersection, could be obtained by solving these two equations together. If you would recall, the same thing we had done in conic section, where solving these two would actually give you the center of the conic section. So you can apply this to find the, you can also apply this to find the center of a conic. So you can use it for a circle, hyperbola, ellipse. Getting my point. In the present case, it is helping us to get the point of intersection of the two straight lines. Is the idea clear?
Yes.
Chalo, we'll take a quick exercise on this so that the concept is clear in your mind. My question is, find the point of intersection of the two lines whose combined equation is 12x square minus 10xy plus 2y square plus 11x minus 5y plus 2 equal to 0. Yeah, for that we need to look into the partial derivative itself, the concept of partial derivative itself, which is beyond our scope right now. Yeah. You have to do some reading on partial derivatives. I can suggest you a very good book for that. Shanti Narayan, Partial Derivative. You may find the soft copy. Guys, a lot of books you can avail easily on zs-lib.org. Okay. If you feel you want some, you know, high level book or some book which is not prescribed or not available in the market normally, you can find this on this online library, z-lib.org. Shanti Narayan, differential equation, differential calculus book, you can find that concept. But again, do you want to waste that precious time of yours? You are in class 12 right now. We can do a lot of activities, you know, before, after your JEE exam. Okay, now two ways. You can solve this question, one by getting the lines themselves and solving them simultaneously. But remember, this is a waste of time. Okay. And the second way is you simultaneously solve these two. Okay. This is time efficient. Okay. I'll do both the ways and show you. Yeah, see, Param is already ready with the answer. Okay, I'll do both the ways and show you. By the way, many people ask me, sir, when you do partial derivative like this, does it give you the two lines which represent this pair of straight lines? The answer is may or may not. In fact, it may not most of the time. Right? It just means that there exist two such lines whose point of intersection is the same as the point of intersection of these two. It doesn't mean they have to be the same lines themselves. For example, let's say these are the original lines. They meet at some point x1, y1. Okay. There can be some other two lines also which meet at the same point x1, y1. So these two lines are obtained from dou s by dou x equal to 0 and dou s by dou y equal to 0. It needn't be the original lines, guys. Let me tell you.
So what's the condition for the two lines being the original lines?
For the two lines, what is the condition for two lines to be the original lines?
Yes, sir.
There is no such condition. You have to solve them, actually. You have to solve the equation. How do I solve it? I'll tell you that. But from this, I'm saying that this may not give you. In fact, I should say, I will not say the word may not, because I have not seen a case so far, my solution. I can say this will not give you.
Okay.
So first I will solve these two first, because the second one is, easy to get. Then I'll check with the original lines. So dou s by dou x will give you 24x minus 10y plus 11 equal to 0. Correct? Yes or no? And dou s by dou y equal to 0 will give you minus 10x.
Minus 10x plus 4y minus 5.
Minus 5 equal to 0. Okay. Let's, without wasting much time, sketch them on the GeoGebra tool. Okay. I don't want to solve them simultaneously. I want to save your time and my time as well. By the way, the people who are new to this class, I normally use some graphing software to plot the lines. Desmos is one of them. Other one is GeoGebra. So we have 24x, hope you can see my screen, minus 10y plus 11 equal to 0. Okay, and the other line will be minus 10x plus 4y minus 5 equal to 0. Okay.
X comes 1 by 2.
Okay, so where do they intersect? Where do they intersect?
So I got x is 1 by 2, is that correct?
Yeah, I think it's minus. No, I think it's minus 3 by 2.
As you can see, this is the intersection point, A.
Yeah, I got 3 by 2.
Minus 3 by 2.
Five. Minus 3 by 2.
3 by 2 and minus 5 by 2.
Yeah, I got the signs wrong.
This is the intersection point.
Yeah, I got y as
5 by 2. Minus 3 by 2, minus 5 by 2.
Oh, I took
yeah,
one of those wrong.
One second.
Sorry.
Yeah. Now, what I'll do is, correct, Pranav. X is minus 3 by 2, Y is minus 5 by 2.
Yeah, X is minus 3 by 2.
Akansha also, correct. Rajdeep also. Rajdeep, check your Y.
Yes, it's minus 3 by 2 and minus 5 by 2.
Right. Yeah, now, okay. I will get the same result. Sorry. I'll get the same result by getting the equation of the two lines. Now, this itself is an exercise. Okay, all of you please follow here, because you may get also this question asked. What are the two lines which represent a pair of statements? You know that method also. Okay, so all of you please pay attention. In solving such cases, we first try to focus on the second degree terms. Remember, I had done a similar question in the beginning of today's session. So take the second degree equation. Remember, line parallel to the two lines and one comma one. In the same way, I will factorize this guy. I'm sure this is easy to factorize. If it is not, you can use your Sridhar Acharya formula also for that. So this can be broken as minus six
minus four
xy minus four xy plus two y square. Take a 6x common, so you get 2x minus y. Take a
minus two y.
2x minus y. Okay, so you get 6 minus 2y, I'll put some gap over here, and 2x minus y, and I'll put some gap over here. Now this gap is because I know there are other terms also, correct? That is 11x minus 5y plus 2, so there has to be some constants present over here. So I'm claiming that this pair of straight lines is made up of product of this plus this. Correct? Now, how do I get L and how do I get an M? Okay, so all of you please pay attention. In order to get L and M, so Vikas has a question. Yeah, but how do you find the point of intersection themselves? Let's say I don't want to use dou S by dou X method, partial derivative method. Vikas.
Yes.
Yeah, so the problem is we can't use the partial derivative if I want to get the, let's say I don't want to use this to get the equations. Anyways, now how do I get L and M? All of you please focus. In the multiplication of these two, what will be the coefficient of X? Let's see. When these two multiply and when these two multiply, I will get an X. That means 2L plus 6M is the coefficient of X. Compare it with the coefficient of X over here.
11.
That's 11.
Okay.
Second, compare the coefficient of y. So y will be obtained when this multiplies to m and this multiplies to l. So minus l minus 2m will be equal to minus 5. Correct. Okay. Yeah. Let's solve for l and m. Let me multiply this with a 2. So 2, let me write it separately. So 2L plus 6M is equal to 11 and minus 2L minus 4M is equal to minus 10. Okay. If you add them,
M is equal to
1/2.
If M is 1/2, we can say L is going to be?
And 4. Right?
L is going to be?
4.
Correct. So my two lines that I will get would be respectively 6X minus 2Y.
Plus 4 equal to 0.
And the other one would be 2x minus y. Plus and m is what?
Plus 1 by 2.
Now, without waste of time, I will just check whether this point here satisfies them or not. So put a minus 3/2 over here. What do you get? Minus 9. Put a minus 5/2 here, you get a plus 5. Plus 4 equal to 0. Satisfied?
Yes, sir.
Put in the second one, minus 2x, 2x will be minus 3. Minus 5 will be 5/2 plus half. So 3 minus 3, 0. That is also satisfied. Correct? But these two are not the same lines that we had obtained while we were doing the partial derivative. As you can see. Okay?
So, I mean, it's not like that time consuming also.
It is not time consuming. I mean, here we were lucky that it got factorized and LMN values were like coming from very simple simultaneous
equations. Yeah.
But partial derivative is like direct.
Partial derivative is very direct. You directly end up getting these two lines.
The and intersection you get.
Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
So what does the partial derivative mean here, sir, geometrically?
See, it tells you that if you keep your y constant, how does your x change? In a 3D structure, right, you can keep any one of the variables constant and the other two varying. Correct? So s is like your z and your x, if you have kept x as a variable and y as constant, you're doing a partial derivative with respect to x if you're differentiating that. Got the point?
Okay,
sir.
Yes.
Shreya has a doubt. Can we consider that the equation to be a quadratic in y when a variable x is a part of it? Yes, we can. Yeah, we can take it as a quadratic in y when there's an x in it. In that case, yes, the coefficients will be variables themselves, not constants. Okay, Karthik has asked me to go to the previous page. Okay, Karthik, I'm going to the previous board. Do you want me to drag up, drag down? Let me know. Done, Karthik? Done, okay. So let's move on to the next concept. Next concept, as we had taken up in our homogeneous pair of straight lines equation, angle between the two lines. Angle between the pair of lines represented by the general second degree equation. Not a homogeneous in this case, but a general second degree equation. Guys, now just want you to answer this. Will G, F, and C play any role in the angle?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Will not. We had just now seen that in the previous example. Sorry, I missed out my spot. In the previous example, we saw that the second degree equation contains the knowledge about the slope. These terms G, F, and C arise because of the constants involved in those two equations. Remember L and M we had taken in the previous example? Those L and M were, L and M were responsible for this G, F, and C terms.
Yeah.
So my theory here is plain and simple. The angle of intersection will still hold to be the same expression that we had derived in the homogeneous equation. You can also say that even if you shift your origin and bring your origin to the intersection point, these three terms are not going to be disturbed. And if these three terms are not going to be disturbed, your angle between the two lines is still going to hold the same formula. Is that fine? Guys, any question here?
No, sir.
So I didn't understand like the last part which you said, like if you shift the origin, how exactly does it not affect?
Yeah, in this case, let's say we have two lines and the angle between them is theta and this is x1, y1. Okay.
Yes.
If you shift your origin to this point, let's say you brought your origin to this point, what will happen? This equation, the first three terms will remain as such. Only this G, F, and C terms will make changes.
Okay.
Because if you try doing this operation, let me show you that operation. If you do x plus x1 square, 2h x plus x1 y plus y1, and
by plus
y1 square. Yeah. If you just focus on x square coefficient, it will be a only.
Yeah.
If you focus on xy coefficient, it will be 2h.
Yeah.
And if you focus on y square coefficient, it will be b only. Yeah. Rest only, you will have more, you know, some changes happening to this guy.
Okay.
But these three guys will not change.
Yeah.
Okay. So whatever we are going to get, they will all be 0, 0 only, right?
Yeah, correct.
Because you're shifting your origin to this position.
Yeah.
So the angle doesn't change on shifting of origin. That's what I'm trying to say about.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, let's take up this question. Acha, before we move on, I would like you to just derive the formula for point of intersection also and keep it. I'm sorry, I'm asking you to derive this because we had already learned a method, very beautiful method to find the point of intersection. But let's have a formula for this ready because I have seen many questions which require you to use this point of intersection formula for this general second degree equation. In fact, I'm going to give you this formula and let's quickly derive it. So the formula is the point of intersection x1, y1 is given by bg minus hf by h square minus ab, comma af minus gh by h square minus ab. So this is very easy to derive. We can always follow our old method. Okay. Now you must be wondering if the original equation is given to us. We can follow this directly and not deal with A, B, H, G, F, and C terms. There you will have numbers in place of them. Numbers are always very convenient to deal with. But let us use this and get this formula. And I'll also tell you the way to remember it. Why I'm asking you to remember it? Because I have seen there are many questions where they use these kind of expressions in the options. Okay. And in those cases, you need to be aware of it. So partial derivative will give you 2ax. I'm dropping the factor of 2 here. And this will give me 2hy, so hy. And here I will get a g. And partial derivative of y will give me, from here I will get 2hx, so I'll write hx only. 2by, so I'll write by only. And here I will get an f. Okay. Now you can use your cross multiplication method that we had discussed a little while ago to solve this. So ab minus h square will come down over here. For minus y, gh minus af will come. Oh, sorry. AF minus GH will come. I've already taken a negative sign here. So AF minus GH will come. And for one, AB minus. Oh, have I done a mistake over here?
So you did the other way around.
I'm sorry, sorry. This is HF.
Sorry. Minus BH.
HF minus BH. Sorry. And this will be AB minus H square. So from here, you can get X as, just take this term and the last term, take it up. Switch the position of the denominator. So you'll have BG minus HF by H square minus AB. That's what we have over here. Take the last two over here, these two, and you can say Y is equal to AF minus GH by H square minus AB. Okay, so that's how we get this stuff. Is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Now, the way to remember this formula is very easy. You don't have to derive this every time. Do you remember I had written a determinant while I was deriving the condition to represent a pair of straight lines? I had written this determinant. Sorry. I had written this, correct? While I was deriving the condition for a pair of straight lines. Okay, this is what I have written. Just write down the first two rows. I'll tell you how to remember it. AH, HB, GF. Okay, then repeat the first row over here. Okay, now do a cross multiplication. Like this. So cross multiplication here will give you AB minus H square. Cross multiplication here will give you HF minus BG. Cross multiplication here will give you GH minus AF. You know how to do cross multiplication, right? It is always left top with right bottom first. So this operation will happen first. Then this operation will happen. Okay. Now divide throughout with AB minus H square. So if you divide this by, this will become a 1. This will become HF minus BG by AB minus H square. And this will become GH minus AF by AB minus H square. Basically, this and this becomes your X1 and Y1. Done. As you can check with this, this is actually this term and this is actually this term. You can switch the position of the terms in the numerator and denominator.
Yes, got it.
This is for your memory aid. Cool. So now we'll take up a question. If you want to note this down, please note it. Can we take up a question now? Ready? Oh, sorry. Let me move on to the next page. Okay, so let's take this question. So if this equation represents, if this equation represents a pair of straight lines, which are parallel. Okay. Now, when I say they are parallel, I don't mean to say they are coincident. Okay, so here parallel means they are not coincident. They are something like this. Then prove that H would be either root AB or minus root AB. And G under root B will be equal to F under root A, or G under root B will be equal to minus F under root A. And then after we are done with this, we'll talk about the second part, that is the distance between them. Let's have around 2.5 minutes for doing the first part. Type done once you are done with it, then I'll discuss it. If you have no clue, type no clue so that I know you're not moving ahead and I can start the discussion. Again, I'm repeating, parallel lines here does not mean coincident. Kritika, try it out. Whatever comes in your mind, try it out. So Ruchir has done with the first part. Okay, yeah, tan formula gives you the first part, that is h square is equal to ab. But how would you get the second part? Second part as in how would you get this guys, these guys, this and this. These two you will get from tan formula, correct? Param. Yeah, you can also think it like this, that the point of intersection is infinity, so denominator should be undefined. So h square is equal to ab, so h is equal to plus minus root of ab. That is also a way to look at it. Guys, mind you, the previous derivation, there was h square minus ab term in the denominator. Okay, so if that term is zero, and if the numerator is not zero, then you can say the lines are meeting at infinity means they are parallel to each other. We'll have a good discussion about it, don't worry. That's correct, Mehul. That would help you to solve the first part of the first part. That is h square is equal to ab wala. But how would you solve the ones which I have shown with this zigzag underline? That's the question. Guys, one more minute and then I'll begin with the discussion for the first part.
So do you in some way use the point of intersection formula for that?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
So would it work if we use partial derivatives, then try to solve it?
That's a really nice trend. Yeah, I don't think.
Okay, there are so many speculations going around. Let me deal with this question, at least the first part. Okay, then second part I'll leave up to you to do it. See, many of you have claimed that I would use the condition that they are parallel. So, you know, if you go back to the previous slide, for them not to meet, basically you are saying h square is minus ab should be zero. Okay. But by the way, that is true when your denominator is not zero. Okay. If both numerator and denominator are zero, they will be coincident lines. We'll see that in some time. Okay. So this clearly solves the first of the first part. That is, proving h is equal to under root ab and this. So if they are parallel, this guy must be zero as a necessary condition. Okay. As a necessary condition, this must be true. So these are the outcomes from this particular result. Correct? No doubt about it. Okay. But how would I solve the other part? That is, how do I prove g under root b is f under root a, or g under root b is minus f under root a? For that, I have to start from scratch. What I do here is, if I'm claiming that this represents two parallel lines, can I assume the equation to be lx plus my plus n and lx plus my plus n1? Remember, since they are parallel, I am keeping these two as same in both the lines, and I'm only changing them in the constant terms. Okay. So remember, two parallel lines only differ in their constant terms. You can always make the x and y coefficients same. Okay. Now, comparing the coefficients, a is l square, b is m square. Here, any doubt about this? Okay. What about C? C is NN1. Correct. What about the X term? 2G, if I'm not mistaken, 2G will be N1L plus NL. So I can say LN plus N1. 2F will be what? 2f will be what? M times n plus n1. Correct? What will be the h term? 2h term would be 2lm. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. Now, we know that the condition for it to represent a pair of straight lines is what? What is the condition for it to represent a pair of straight lines? ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CH square equal to zero. Okay. Guys, this may not be used right now. I'll use it in some time. Now use the fact that H is equal to under root AB in this. Okay, so I can write this as A, B, C. Okay, this will be what? 2FG under root AB. Okay, minus AF square minus BG square. And this will again become AB.
Minus ABC.
Correct? ABC, ABC gone. Correct? Now look at the remaining terms. You can multiply throughout with a negative sign also. I claim that this term on the left hand side of the equation is actually under root AF plus, minus under root BG whole square. Agreed? Which clearly means F under root A must be equal to G under root B. Isn't it what we wanted to prove here? F under root A is G under root B. So first part is proved. Okay. If you took H as negative under root AB, then see what will happen. Again, look at this equation. ABC will remain unchanged. Let it be ABC. 2FGH will become minus 2FG under root AB. Correct? Minus AF square will remain changed. Minus BG square will remain unchanged. Minus CS square will again become minus ABC. Correct? Isn't it?
So it becomes plus whole square.
Right. So if you take a negative sign common throughout and remove it, you end up getting actually this expression, which happens to be a perfect square of F under root A plus G under root B. So that means F under root A is negative of G under root B. So you end up getting the second part. That is your this part. Is that fine? Now, please go ahead and solve the second part. Hint is, you would require these for part two. Let me know once you're done. Type done once you're done. Okay. So Shreya has a question. Partial derivatives and compare coefficients of A1. Yeah. Okay.
Can you?
It must work, Shreya, because I think the condition will not change. Did you try that out, Shreya?
So I got the lines with partial derivative and then, but then the distance between them is coming to be zero.
Oh, by the way, if they are parallel, Shreya, it will not be equal to C1 by C2. See, parallel means coefficient of X will be same as coefficients of Y, but the it will not be same as the ratio of the coefficients of constant terms. I think there's a slight error in that. See, if you say A1 X, B1 Y plus C1 equal to 0, and A2 X, B2 Y plus C2 equal to 0 are parallel lines, A1 by A2 should be equal to B1 by B2, should not be equal to C1. If the lines are coincident, then it will become equal to C1. Ruchir, can you repeat what did you say just now? Ruchir,
the partial derivative will give you the line, right? The two lines.
Okay, but will it give you both the conditions that we have over here on the plate?
Yes, sir. That's...
Paka? Okay. Yes, anybody who is done with part two other than Ruchir Parikh? That's only for perpendicular lines, so sir, parallel lines tan should be equal to 0 by 0.
So done, sir.
So no, I was adding a 4 instead of the top.
Parallel lines h square should be equal to AB here. I'm not saying 0 by 0 line for condition. 0 by 0 will be for the points of intersection. Not for the angle. Here, if I'm able to convey this to you, when you're dealing with two coincident lines, in the formula of the point of intersection, both numerator and denominator would be zero.
Okay, sir. Sir, but then how would the tan theta formula change? Like, is there any way using that we can figure out that if the lines are parallel or not?
No. Tan theta is necessary but not a sufficient condition. This only tells you that the line are parallel. So it may be parallel, it may be coincident. Okay. This condition is a necessary condition but not a sufficient condition to tell you whether they are parallel or they're coincident. What my point?
Okay, sir. So in the tan theta, if A plus if a plus b is 0, then we can only say for sure that they are perpendicular, nothing else. Okay, thank you, sir.
Chalo, most of you have got it. I'm giving you 30 seconds more to wrap up things, then I'll discuss it.
So instead of lx plus my plus n and lx plus my plus n1, can we take the lines as root ax plus root by plus c1 and root ax plus root by plus c2?
Root?
Root a into x plus root b into y plus c1.
Now that you know that comparison, you can do anything you want. You can take that, no worries. Okay, chalo, we'll discuss this. Enough time has been devoted to this. See guys, let us recall that when two lines are parallel, okay, so I'm just making a fresh diagram over here. When two lines are parallel, okay, what is the distance between them when you know their equation to be lx plus my plus n equal to 0 and lx plus my plus n1 equal to 0?
Mod of n plus n1 by root of a square plus b square.
Yeah, it's actually mod of the difference of their constant terms by under root of l square plus m square. Correct. Now from this comparison, l square and m square is already known to us as a and b. Correct. So we can directly make the change. Let me just drop a divider over here. So we can directly say the denominator part will become under root a plus b. Now, what about the numerator part? I have to play with it. So first of all, I can write this as under root of n plus n1, the whole square minus 4 n1, nn1. Correct? Okay. Now, n plus n1, let me pick it up from this. Let me see what we want to prove. We want to prove g square minus a. So let me pick it up from the expression over here, which I'm showing with the arrow sign.
2g by l.
Okay. Yes. So n plus n1 is 2g by l. And nn1 is already known to us as c. So let us put it over here. I'll end up getting this as 4g square by l square minus 4c. Okay. Let me just pull it up a bit. By under root of a plus b. Okay. So let me do one thing. Let me write everything under one under root symbol. 2 can be taken out. G square minus L square C by L square A plus B. What is L square? What is L square?
A.
So can I not write this as 2 under root of g square minus ac by a plus b? And that gives me what I needed. That is this formula. But this also opened me another route or another way to get the same distance. Had I used my n plus n1 from this equation, that is n plus n1 is 2f by m, then how would this formula change? Let me show you. So in that case, again, I'm going back to this step. It would have become d is equal to under root of 2f by m the whole square. So let me just write it directly. 4f square by m square minus 4c by a plus b. Okay. Again, performing the same operations, I can say under root of.
So f square minus ac by d into a plus b.
Absolutely. So you'll end up getting 2 under root of f square minus ac by b a plus b. So there is a small change here. Instead of g, we have got an f, and instead of a plus b in the denominator, we have got b a plus b. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Make sense? By the way, this is going to be BC, not AC. This is BC. Because M square is B, no? Slip off pen. So both are the distances between the two parallel lines. Okay, so both can be used. Okay. Now, one more analysis is pending over here. If I claim that your equation, that is your second degree equation, represents coincident lines, if they represent coincident lines, can I say that g square will be equal to AC, f square will be equal to BC, and h square will be equal to AB simultaneously? Yes or no, guys? Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why is this so? Because this term will become zero.
This will become zero because
the distance term will become zero because the distance will collapse. They have become coincident. See here, coincident. Okay, they will be overlapping on each other. Correct. Now, from these three expressions, can you show me that?
So, why the third one, sir?
Because they are parallel. Coincident lines are by default parallel. No, the angle between them will be zero. No?
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay. So, this is a necessary condition. And apart from that, you need these two conditions to show they are coincident. So, just stating h square equal to ab can imply two things. The line may be parallel or coincident. Now, I want you to show me that BG will be equal to HF also in this case, and AF will be equal to GH. So from these, can you derive these two guys also? If you're not able to show this exact thing, you show b square g square is equal to h square f square, which is obvious. If you do b square g square, you end up getting b square ac by using the first expression, and h square is ab and f square is bc. Isn't it giving you a b square c is equal to a b square c? That means yes, this will also be true. In a similar way, you can show that af will also be equal to gh. Okay, now here is an interesting thing that comes up from this entire exercise. Do you realize that the point of intersection was BG minus HF by H square minus AB, comma, AF minus GH by H square minus AB? It means for a pair of straight lines which are...
Numerator should be zero.
Both will be zero.
Yeah.
Will be zero. Suggesting that it will take an indeterminate structure.
That means no such point exists.
No, there can be several.
All points, sir.
It is taking an indeterminate. Indeterminate form. Indeterminate form, as you would have learned in your limits, 0 by 0. So it can take various forms depending upon your situation. Okay.
So here the situation is like no such point exists, right?
No. Just means that they will meet themselves. Both these lines will meet at infinitely many points.
Okay, yeah, correct.
Okay.
Coincidence.
Yes. Okay. Chalo, we'll take some. This is the concept that we have done. And now we are going to talk about equation of the pair of bisector lines for pair of straight lines given by the general second degree equation. So remember, we had done for homogeneous one. What was the formula for the homogeneous one? So if this was the line, what was the equation of the pair of bisectors? Forgotten already, huh?
X square minus y square divided by a minus
y. Then it's b equal to xy by h.
Yeah. Now, tell me, can I use this fact to get the equation of the bisectors of this guy, given that I know their point of intersection? So let's say these two, the lines which are representative of this, meet at x1, y1. Can I use that fact? Absolutely, here, correct. Shifting of origin. But how? Can you guide me on that? You can unmute yourself and speak out. What do you want? So you already had, let's say, a situation where this was origin. Then you know what are the equation of these pair of bisectors, correct? I want to use this to get the pair of bisector for this fellow. How will I do it?
So you substitute x and y.
Somebody is speaking something.
So do you substitute x and y in terms of the shifted origin?
So you take the current equation x square and y square and you reverse shift it to the origin.
Okay. Right now we are at this stage. I want to go to this line. I want to go to these pair of straight lines. So where should I shift my origin?
To that point of intersection.
So you have to shift it to minus x from minus y.
Absolutely. Param is absolutely correct. Guys, origin needs to be shifted to minus x1 minus y1. Then only this point will behave as x1 y1. Correct? Yes or no? See, originally there was a point which was origin. Okay. By mistake, I drew this line. Okay. If you want this point to now become A, B, where should this guy go? This guy should come at minus A, minus B, na? So if this becomes your origin, then only this point will become A, B. So if I want to make something, if I want to push something one unit away from me, I have to move one unit away behind from that point, isn't it? So he's absolutely correct. If you make these changes, if you make this change in the equation of this homogeneous second degree, you will end up getting this particular pair of straight lines. And same changes you have to bring in this equation to get the new pair of bisectors. In other words, all you need to do was replace your x with capital X minus x1. Y with capital Y minus Y1. Guys, please revise shifting of origin concept. I find many people getting muddled up here. So this equation will become capital X minus X1 square minus capital Y minus Y1 square. Given that I know X1, Y1, so I'm assuming that I have been able to successfully find X1, Y1 by using my partial derivative approach. So all I need to do is just transform these equations like this. Okay. By the way, we are not used to writing things in capital letters. So you can bring back your capital X and capital Y in terms of small x and small y. So this would be your equation of the pair of bisectors. Is that fine? Okay, so nothing great here. You just have to know your new, You just have to apply the shifting of origin concept to the previous equation that we have learned, and we are through.
So can you explain that shifting part once more? Just one
way. Yeah, sure. See, we are right now at a position where my point of intersection is origin, correct?
Yeah.
We also know they are bisector equations. So these are your bisectors. Okay. I want this guy to become this. So what transformation should I apply? You will say, you have to make this point x1, y1. So where should origin go such that this point is called x1, y1? The origin should go at minus x1, minus y1, isn't it?
Okay.
Because everything is counted with reference to the origin.
Yeah, yeah, okay.
So if you shift your origin from 0, 0 to minus x, minus y, how will this guy react? How will the bisectors react? The bisectors will react.
Yeah.
And then this, the same pair of straight lines will now become your bisector equations.
Okay. Yeah, okay, good.
Got the point?
Yeah.
Okay. So let's have one quick question on this. Yes, Shreya, x1, y1 is the point of intersection. Yeah. Okay. So let's take this question. Let's say the very same line that we had, 12x square minus 10xy plus 2y square plus 11x minus 5y plus 2 equal to 0. Okay, so consider this pair of straight lines. Now I have two questions. One being, find the angle between the lines which constitute this pair. Angle between the lines which constitute this pair. And second is, find the equation of the pair of bisectors of those two lines. My life is actually easy here because we know that the point of intersection was minus 3 by 2 minus 5 by 2. This is actually the old question that we had taken up, so that we don't waste our time finding that. So let's have 1 minute for the first part of the question. That is very simple. Find the angle. That's correct, Ruchir. Ruchir Singh, correct. Hia is also correct. Vikas, silly mistake. Check. Dhruv also, silly mistake. Check. Yeah, yeah, of course. Tan, your answer will only be in terms of tan inverse only. You can state tan inverse. Correct, Rahul. Correct, Param. Okay, guys, first part very easy. It only depends upon these guys. The last three terms do not have any role to play. So tan of theta would be 2 under root h square minus ab by a plus b. You can put a mod. So 2. Okay. Now, what is your h here? H here is minus 5. So this is 25 minus ab is 24 by mod a plus b is mod 14. Okay. That gives you 1 by 7. So theta is tan inverse 1 by 7. Next is, find out the equation of the bisectors. Now, just write done if you're done. I don't want you to write that down. Okay, so for bisectors, all you need to do is just have this framework in your mind ready. This was the basic framework for the equation of the bisectors. All you need to do is replace this guy with x minus x1. So this will become 3 by 2. Okay. Minus y plus 5 by 2. By a minus b. A minus b is 12 minus 2. and this will be equal to xy, x, y by h. H is minus y. Okay. You can simplify it at your own end. I don't want you to waste time. I have one more concept to quickly wrap up in the last 15 minutes. So guys, just need your attention over here. I know you all are very tired. Online 4 hour session is slightly tiring. Okay. One last session and we'll almost complete this chapter. The last concept that we are going to talk about is the concept of homogenization. Is the concept of homogenization. Homogenization. Listen to this idea. This concept says that if you have a second degree equation curve, so let's say this is a curve whose equation is a second degree. So it can be a conic, isn't it? Conics have second degree equations. So it could be a circle, it could be an ellipse, it could be a parabola, hyperbola. And let us say there is a straight line. Let me call the straight line as Lx plus My plus N equal to 0. Okay. Now this concept of homogenization says, if from the origin you draw two lines which connect origin to their point of intersection, then the combined equation of these pair of lines, so you can see those green lines L1 and L2. So the combined equation of this two green lines L1 and L2 can be obtained by homogenizing Lx plus My plus N equal to 0 with the second degree equation over here. Now guys, let me tell you, this second degree equation is a conic. Okay. It could be a pair of straight lines also. Getting my point? Okay. So how does it work? And what is the process of homogenization? What do I mean by this? Homogenization means you have to convert this equation into a homogeneous second degree term. That means every term here should become a second degree term. You must be wondering how it will become a second degree term. Let me show how. So what I'll do here is I will write this equation first like this. Lx plus My is equal to minus N, which can further be written as, I have some question here. Karthik, we are trying to find out the equation of L1 and L2, but not separately. As a combined equation we want. Of course, there are other ways to do it. People will say, sir, I will sit and find their point of intersection. Then I will construct these two lines. Then I will multiply it, etc., etc. Yes, you can do it like this. But the method which I'm going to tell you is a very, very handy one. And you'll get many locus-based questions on this particular concept. Okay, so I'll write it over here. This concept is useful for locus questions. Now see how it works. So here what I do is I obtain one like this. So let me call this as equation one. Now what I do here, since I'm homogenizing it, the second degree terms I will not disturb. So whichever terms are second degree, I will copy them as such. Now here if you see, there's a first degree term. This is a degree one term. So what I'll do is I'll put a one over here. This is also a first degree term. So I'll also put a one over here. And C is a zero degree term. So I'll put a one square over here. Now this one that I have put over here, I'll replace my one with Lx plus My by minus N. Okay. So if I do that, I end up getting something like this. As you can see here, every term in this equation, every term here would be a second degree. Every term would be a second degree term. Okay, so we know that a second degree equation, a homogeneous second degree equation like this, will always represent a pair of straight lines intersecting at origin or passing through origin. This is only what I wanted, right? We wanted these two lines. Isn't it a pair of straight lines passing through origin? So yes, again, I'm using the concept that a pair of homogeneous second degree equation will actually represent a pair of straight lines passing through origin. Okay, so this is your equation of L1 and L2 combined. And let me tell you, it looks very ugly in this present form, but when you are actually applying it, you'll be able to do it very, very conveniently. Let me show you in a question. Anybody who is willing to copy something? Should I go to the next sheet?
Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Tell me, Ruchir.
Sir, you said that this ax squared plus 2hxy could also be a pair of straight lines. But if it's a pair of straight lines, won't there be four points of intersection?
See, I'm talking about something of this nature. Cut. And these two points are connected to origin.
Okay. Yes. Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
This is your LX plus MY plus N line. And this is the conic which is represented. This is a pair of straight line represented by that second degree.
Yes, thank you, sir.
So what's the proof that these straight lines will intersect at those points?
What is the proof that they will meet at origin?
What's the proof that the lines will intersect at those same points that the first line in the conic intersected at?
Because aren't you simultaneously solving it? The same point which will satisfy the line will also satisfy the conic. The homogenization actually is taking care of that, isn't it? See, let's say here if you had a point x1, y1, won't it make simultaneously the xy of the line and xy of the conic zero simultaneously over here?
Yes, sir. Okay.
Getting the point. See, only term that would have missed out was this term, but this is also taken care of because x and y will satisfy line equation also, right?
Yes, sir.
So it takes care of the fact that these lines L1 and L2 will pass through the very same points where the blue line is meeting the conic.
Okay.
Let's have
so initially when we take the first line with L and we try and homogenize it, mm-hmm. that line is, the equation of that line is for which line?
Once again, Dhruv.
During homogenization, we start off with an equation for a line, right?
It would be given to you.
Yeah, but which line does that represent? Is it the line that intersects the conic?
Yeah, this is the line which intersects the conic. And the one we are finding it are these white lines.
Okay, so when we homogenize the line that intersects the conic, we get the other two, L1 and L2.
Absolutely, absolutely. We are homogenizing this guy with this guy to get this guy.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So here is a very simple question for you. Prove that the pair of straight lines joining the origin to the intersection of the curve, by the way, if you are not able to see this, it's actually our ellipse equation, by this line are coincident if this condition is met. Done? Okay. Let me help you out with this because this is the very first problem you are solving on this concept. So Akshit is done. Anybody else? Param is also done. Now, let's try to understand. Oh no. Sorry guys, load shedding happening. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to homogenize this with this line. So these two terms, they are already second degree. I will not disturb them. What is not second degree is this guy one. Okay. You could have brought the one on the other side also. It doesn't make any difference to our approach. But this one, I would have to homogenize it by using the fact that one could be written as Lx plus My by minus N. Okay. So when we do that, we end up seeing something of this sort. Okay. Now what I'm claiming is that this represents a pair of straight lines, which will be not only passing through origin, but also coincident. So can I say this is coincident? My H square should be equal to AB first of all. Okay. Origin is already taken care of because it is a homogeneous second degree. It's a homogeneous second degree equation. Okay. Now what is my H, what is my A, and what is my B here? Let us try to get those terms from this equation. So X square coefficient here is 1 by A square minus L square by M square, if I'm not wrong. Y square coefficient is 1 by b square minus m square by n square and minus 2 l m x y by n square will be the remaining term.
The first thing where we said x square, isn't it l square by n square?
N square. Yeah, thank you for making that correction. Okay. Correct. Now let's try to apply the formula. H square is equal to AB.
H should be Lm by n square, right? Minus Lm by n square.
Okay, let's do one small thing. Since there's an n square over here, I'll get rid of it by multiplying throughout. I'm just using a simplification over here. It's not a mandatory step. And here I'll get minus 2 Lm xy. Okay, so H square is like L square M square. Okay. And AB will be like N square by A square minus L square and N square by B square minus M square. Correct? Let's see what do we need. Okay, we need to simplify it even more.
So why did you take the condition N square equal to AB?
Because they are coincident. So coincident, the angle must be zero.
Coincident.
The parallel condition is the angle between zero is a sufficient condition also because they're passing through origin and they are parallel, they have to be coincident.
Yeah.
Correct. So that's why I use that. Okay. So let me square this up. Okay, I'm just simplifying this. You could have done this at your own end also. Okay. Cancel off this L square, M square from both the sides. Okay. You could even drop N square term also conveniently, isn't it? So you can write it as, let me write N square by A square B square is equal to M square by A square and L square by B square. Now finally touching just final touch up here. So L square, A square, L square, B square, M square should be equal to N square. A square, B square, I'm cancelling from the denominator. Is this what we wanted to prove? Yes, this is what we wanted to prove. Okay. So this is a very good example where you could use your concept of homogenization. Any question here, anybody? I didn't know why we use the condition of coincidence, because it is given in the question here, Akansha.
So, but it
looks
like
the square of straight lines are coincident. Look here. Yeah. Anybody else?
So we have to prove that they're coincident, right? But we took the condition that they are coincident.
Okay. See, coincident if this and vice versa will also be true.
Okay, fine.
So if they are coincident, then this will be satisfied. And if this is satisfied, they are coincident.
Okay.
So H square is equal to AB. Isn't that the condition for them to be parallel and not coincident?
This is, didn't I write, this is a condition for both the situations, parallel and coincident.
Yes, sir. But by using the parallel condition, what if they're only parallel and not coincident?
No, but it's homogeneous, right? So
it's homogeneous.
Pass through
origin. Oh, yeah.
If homogeneous, parallel will automatically become coincident.
Yeah.
If homogeneous. Okay. Okay, guys, we are done with this chapter. Probably, we'll have to solve more questions. I'll be requesting you to solve the level-wise problems on the rank booster. People who are just newly added, I'll send it once again to you. Okay. So please complete that before you attempt your module questions. Especially concept of homogenization, etc. They are very useful in locus-based. So try to apply them for solving locus-based questions. So next class that we meet, we are going to take up a theory of equations chapter. And then we'll get back to the concept of the leftover part of conics.